Roger's there. Roger, he's
still in the picture at this
point. Thank you.
here's the story. Our dad, I'm going to call Mr. Ludwig for the time being. Mr. Ludwig came to Dowagiac, Michigan in 1910, and nobody knows why. Billy has researched this, other people have researched this, nobody knows why. What was in Dowagiac, Michigan? Normally in those days, you had to have a sponsor. So did Mr. Ludwig have a sponsor in Dowagiac, Michigan? It turns out that a light will go by Kathy, because I met Kathy a couple of days ago, appears on here as a second cousin. So there's some relationship between Kathy and all of us, all of us who are second cousins.
Okay.
And it turns out that Kathy's grandfather, Charles Sawatske, lived in Dowagiac, Michigan about the same time. So there's a very good possibility that Charles and Grandpa Louie are brothers.
Oh, interesting.
Now, Lily has contended for many years that there's a Carl or a Charles somewhere in Michigan, but it could never be proved. And now it's a good possibility that this Kathy is the granddaughter of Charles, and Charles is the brother of Ludwig.
Wow.
So, wow. Okay, so where are his, on your little page, where are his brothers? And how did we not know that?
It's a game.
Because this is just Ludwig and Renata on down.
Oh, okay.
We don't have it going up.
Oh, okay.
We know this. We know that Joseph Sawatske is in Minneapolis.
Okay, and he was a brother?
And he was a brother,
okay.
For sure.
Okay.
And I correspond with his granddaughter, Lulu, her name is. She lives in Baltimore. We also know that Theodore Sawatske was a brother, and Theodore married Grandma's sister, Marie.
Yeah, I remember that.
And then they were divorced here in Michigan. They were married in Russia, as was Grandma and Grandpa. And they were divorced in Michigan. We have the papers.
Okay.
And Charles and his wife Helen, and Charles was an abuser. And his wife Helen, with three children, left him and put the children in an orphanage. And then remarried a gentleman who had five children in an orphanage because he had lost his wife to cancer. So these two people are visiting their children, and they decided, let's make a family out of it. So now it's a family of 10.
Wow.
So they have a son by the name of Adolf, and Adolf is Kathy's father. So Adolf's father is Charles. And the fact that the DNA from Kathy is so close, and there's markers that are involved with this, that it's a very good possibility that we found your Uncle Charles.
Wow.
Now there
and
are markers.
There are markers. He got the email.
There are markers involved with this, and I don't understand it, but my daughter Chris's father is a professor of genetics at the University of Michigan. And I explained the situation to him, and he said, it's a little iffy that this is true. He said, it's a possibility, but it's a little iffy that this is true. However, I'm going to bring him the data, and he's going to take a look at it. Now, I don't understand exactly how this works, but he said, you know, there's 23 chromosomes of one and 23 of the other, and they could combine and all this. And then he says, think of it as a rope. And there's sections of the rope that ancestry tests. So Alfred's section of the rope and my section of the rope determines that there's a relationship between Alfred and me.
Right.
Charlie said, in order for this to be 100% sure, ancestry would have to spend $100,000 per person. Because you just can't take a little section of this long rope, this long, a little section here.
Oh.
But he said, based on what I told him, And when I bring, and there's a term for all of this, that he's going to do an analysis and let us know.
But doesn't he know about the heredity of corn?
He does.
That's his expertise.
He's the popcorn man. And interestingly enough, he wrote a textbook on genetics in 1984. We were with my daughter, and I mentioned this to her, and her son, Evan, said, "I have the book." So he went up and got the books on you.
Cool, cool.
How about corn?
No, about genetics.
Oh,
yeah.